So our next talk will be for Mark Baden and Alexandre Maes. So Mark Baden, who is also a co-organizer of this session, he's a BPI research director at the CNRS in Paris. So he has a very long experience, since 15 years. He's postdoctoral researcher. And he's quite well known for a lot of different molecular dynamic simulation approaches. And in addition, what he's actually doing is he's combining this since already a number of years with virtual reality related technologies. So he did, for example, experiments with the Phantom. Maybe you know this. Maybe he will show it on his slide. I'm not sure about that, where you can interact with molecules in 3D space. And one of his important projects in this context is Nunitimol. I think we will hear a little bit more about this later on. So, and his co-author, who will later join, Alexandre Maes, he's a bioinformatics engineer at the CNRS in Paris. And he did his PhD in RNA stability and small RNA regulations in bacteria and developed different RNA cloning strategies. Yeah, so we are very much looking forward to your talk. So please start.
Thank you very much for the introduction, Björn. Thank you, Aurelio, for being here. I would like to introduce to you our platform called Minomics, an integrative and immersive tool for multi-omics analysis, where we try to use 3D stereoscopy to explore and mine data sets. Basically, we have three ingredients I will present together with my colleague Alexandre. And actually, Xavier is also here. He will do the demo session this afternoon. And so there are three components that are important in this project. Of course, the data that we are looking at, that will be omics data, and again from this organism that you just heard about by Björn. So my introduction about the data is done. Thank you, Björn. And of course, then the hardware and the software that we have to drive this data mining tool is important. So I start to comment about the hardware. So our setup, we have a special display wall room in the institute that you can see schematically here. And so you can see here a few of the characteristics of the display wall. It's full stereoscopic, 120 hertz, and this resolution here. It's about 8 square meters, 4.4 by 2 meters. It's run by a workstation with a Quadro M4000 GPUs. And we also have in the same room the possibility to have a VR headset. So you can, in principle, switch between a fully immersive VR and a display wall stereoscopy. That leaves for a number of interesting setups that we can explore. So basically these are the setups. The first one is you just use the screen in monoscopy, and we have both the omics data and the 3D view of the 3D objects that's available. And then we can progressively do different variations. We can have half the screen with a 2D and half the screen full stereoscopy. The advantage is that then we can have many users, up to 15 about in that room. Or we have scenarios where we have a group of people looking at the 2D screen, and there can be a link of the 3D view to a WebVR headset for one of the persons, and then they can interact. Or we can have everything fully immersive in VR. So we explored these four scenarios, as I just said, from fully monoscopic to fully immersive 3D VR. And for example, in the fully immersive 3D VR, it could look like something like this. Here you have a protein network shown in 3D, and then you have a plane onto which we project the actual web interface to the Minomics server. Okay, then you can explore all your different data sets. And that's actually a context where what Michael talked about earlier, the kind of semantic link between those two spaces would help you by uttering voice commands to drive that system. So you don't have to take care about too complex 3D interactions. Okay, then the other components, of course, very important is the software. Basically, we have a framework where we have a server part and a client part, and that also depends very much, I mean, the design of this software framework depended very much on the data set that we looked at, and Alexandre will describe that in more detail.
So I'm Alex, so I will briefly present you the biological data set we use in our Minomics pipeline and the architecture that we do. So I will briefly remind you how the gene expression works in all living cells. So maybe you know that all the genetic information is stored in a very stable molecule that is called DNA, that is transcribed in labile molecule RNA in multiple conditions, and this molecule is then translated into proteins. So I'll focus for this talk on the point that proteins that are large macromolecules that can be post-translationally modified by external conditions. So omics, recent high-throughput technology allows to collect numerous information on the quality and quantity of either RNA or peptides, and you have also information on post-translationally modified protein amino acids on these proteins. So this is the omics dataset that you have when you perform the experiments. So this is the process dataset. So you have plenty informations and very heterogeneous informations. About each line is a protein or a transcript of a genes. And for one experiment, you have 1,000 or 2,000 protein or genes or transcripts. And that constitutes the proteome or a transcriptome of the cell. So before being a web developer, I was like this 10 years ago. I was a scientist. And when I was reading the papers, I was finding this list of omics data, so thousands of proteins or genes, and I have to connect them between them to find a meaning of all of these results. So you have to keep in mind that this is our results for one experiment, but we have to connect them between the numerous biological databases that you can find on the web that are constituted by millions or sometimes billions of information about protein structures, protein annotation, gene annotation, ontologies, and or protein families. So on the previous slide, you can easily understand that the human mind cannot interconnect by itself all of this data. And with the powerful computer, you can translate the human biological questions to computer questions. So this is the Minomics frameworks. So it's a web-based framework. So you have, as Mark said before, the client part and the server parts. So here it's just a computer, but Mark show you that you can have the VR wall, the screen wall. So you can perform many tasks on the client side that are transferred through the network to the server parts. So I will focus on the server part that has to be highly efficient to perform biological queries to interrogate the database here. So to be highly efficient and to ensure immersion and interaction with this amount of information in the database, you have to store the information in this object relational database. It's PostgreSQL in this case. So you store all the information in different levels. So level 0 is the organism or experiment information. The level 1 is all the omics information I told you just before. And level 2 and 3 regroups all the external biological database you can find on the web. So this organization, indexing, and linkage allows the user to perform complex tasks in a few milliseconds here. So to collect millions of gene ontology corresponding to 1,000 protein, you can have these results in between 4 and 6 milliseconds. So this part is really important to ensure the interaction from the user to the database. So the database we use, so it's based on structured query language that allows multiple operations. Here, just briefly, 4 different operations, that is filtering, grouping, merging, or comparing. It's task very important for the biologists that want to compare one experiment with another, that want to filter the protein that are interested in. And you can find here the representation. Each bubble, it's a node that contains data sets, an experiment or data sets of proteins in an organism. And you can select the different protein. You can select subgroups of proteins. You can filter them in real time. And you can here explode each node with the constituent. And you can see here more than 1,000 proteins that constitute the protein networks between different experiments. And from this 2D representation, we have to go to 3D to fully explore the data sets. And Mark will continue.
Yeah, so from here then to connect this core of the database to a 3D, we used an implementation based on Unity that we had done for some time called UnityMol, which was basically designed to display molecules, but also networks of molecules. And in particular, because this is a web framework, we used a WebGL export. And so we updated our protein network visualization, and we implemented a few features that are useful in 3D. For instance, you can tug on these networks and try to modify them. We basically want to connect this to the physics engine so that people can try to rearrange in different ways these networks. Or you can add a third dimension simply by expanding a 2D view and then adding some mapping, some parameter on the third dimension that you can then manipulate. To get actually the 3D working in this web context was not so obvious. So we added some WebVR compatibility to that WebGL version of UnityMol. So basically looks something like this. And then you can call up, like if you're an HTC Vive or Cardboard, you can call that up from that context. Okay, so now what type of research do we try to enhance with this type of approach? It's basically in the context of the redox biology of this algae. We try to understand how this oxidative stress transforms into changes in the modifications of the different proteins. So you have these three types of changes that can be observed: glutationylation, nitrosylation, and disulfide bridge formation. And to combine from this proteome level, where you have the ensemble of molecules in that algae, down to the structural level, where we can see the modification, which of the cysteine molecules that are residues that are modified, which of the cysteines is targeted and why. So basically starting from a 3D modeling of the whole proteome of Chlamydomonas, about 2,000 proteins, we started to try and come up with structural interpretations. For example, the microenvironment of the cysteines that are modified, how does it decide which cysteine will be modified? And we would like to be able to predict from the structure the redox modifications. So here the example I will try to show you is on the nitrosylome network, just one of those three modifications. So that's basically how Minomics would look like, and the work pipeline would be select one data set, for instance, nitrosylome, then look at one property like the accessibility of a given residue, is it accessible or buried? Then for those that were selected, we look at the secondary structure. We can see that in the buried ones, there's much more beta than in the other data set. And by visual inspection, we also see that these ones have a specific fold, 3D fold, called a Rossmann fold, in 9 out of 14 cases. Then we can say, okay, is this just a chance accident, or can we compare it to the control data set, for instance, for another modification? And we also come up with a significant proportion of these types of modifications. So basically, in terms of Minomics, what you do then is you define a certain number of filters. The first filter focuses on the nitrosylated proteins, then on the ones that are buried, on a beta sheet and a Rossmann-like fold, and that actually is connected directly to a 3D view, where I then select the corresponding protein view in 3D. And then we can also build on features of UnityMol that were already implemented, for instance, the best point of view algorithm that brings you directly to the cysteine of interest and tries to choose the best point of view orientation of your camera so you get a good view on the cysteine residue. And so to summarize on this use case, so if you compare the exposed cysteines to the buried ones, you can see there's a significantly expanded proportion of beta sheets with a specific fold. And here you can see four examples, and the cysteines here are all in very similar environment. You can see here helix to the left, etc., the so-called Rossmann fold. So this is something we try to verify whether it is generalizable and whether it would be one rule to say which of the cysteines are modified in these systems. Okay, and that's basically all I wanted to tell you for now. You can get more information in the demo session this afternoon where we try to demo a few of these examples if it works, and I'm happy to take any questions.